Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's live coverage of VMware Explore here in Las Vegas. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside my co-host and co-analyst, John Furrier. John, let's talk cybersecurity.
Yeah, I mean, AI is one of the hottest areas, and everyone knows that it's very vulnerable at many levels, so this conversation is perfect. Obviously, balancing out the traffic, understanding all the nuances, MCP servers are hot. It looks good on paper, but there's a lot of things to watch. This should be a lot of fun.
The bad guys are everywhere. So, yeah. So with that, I'd like to introduce our next guest. We have Umesh Mahajan, VP and GM Application Networking and Security Division at Broadcom. Welcome back to theCUBE.
Thank you so much. So happy to be here.
And Gillon Helman, Coal Engineering. Thank you so much for coming on theCUBE.
Thank you for having me.
So, Umesh, I'm going to start with you. You've just rolled out some new capabilities. This show, there have been so many new product announcements, mm-hmm. but in particular, capabilities for VMware Defend, vDefend. Mm-hmm. Tell our viewers a little bit about what's new and what the big takeaways are.
So there were several announcements, but two major areas. One is we want to get our customers deployed quickly and get the value, because they buy the product and then they take a long time to typically get deployed because they are limited in staff. So we are doing a lot of work in the product itself, ask a few simple questions, use some AI ML techniques, and then come up with the firewall rules in a stepwise manner so that they can get deployed. Second area of focus is AI and Gen AI. How do we do two things with it? We kind of raise the productivity, we come up with intelligent assist or copilot for our products so that the customers can, you know, be more productive as they use our product. And the other one is secure AI and agentic AI workloads. So we have a plan and a strategy how to do that. So those are our big focus areas.
Can you walk us through, I mean, as you said, you oftentimes come out with new products and then there's a lag time between how customers deploy them. Can you walk us through a little bit how it's happening faster and easier now?
So what we are doing is first we want to give them visibility or figure out what is my risk posture? Where am I with security? Because many people, sometimes people are in a false sense of, you know, that thing that, hey, I'm secure because I did a few firewall rules. No, you are not. So we can show them, this is where you really stand. This is your risk posture. This is your security score. From there, then we can tell them, these are the exact steps you can do to increase your security posture. And then we have come up with three prescriptive stages, stage one, two, three. You secure your infrastructure services, rather easy to do that, so rogue ransomware attacks don't happen by masquerading as RDP, DNS, and all that stuff, so we lock that down. Second is you reduce your attack surface by doing zoning or macro segmentation, that again is easy. Production is separate from development, is separate from DMZ. Third is where you get to the application level segmentation. And that's, while it's a little bit more data you need and you need to know what you're up to, again, it can be simplified and automated, and that's exactly what we are doing. So instead of customers taking years, we think they can, within weeks and months, they can get it completely deployed.
Wow. And Gillon, for those who aren't familiar, tell our viewers a little bit about Coal Engineering.
Yeah, so Coal Engineering has been around since 2004. We're primarily a training software company. However, back in 2018, we started in the cybersecurity realm. We are the primary on a contract called Cyber Trident, which is under US Cyber Command. We run the PCTE, which is the Persistent Cyber Training Environment. Primarily what we do is we provide individual and collective training to all the cyber mission forces under US Cyber Command. So that's Army, Navy, Marine Corps, Air Force, Coast Guard, National Guard, the works, right? And our foreign partners as well. And so it's a full life cycle training system. We train everything from your fresh out of basic training, what is a firewall, right? How do you implement firewall rules? What is TLS, things like that. All the way up to you're now part of a cyber protection team and you need to execute an offensive or defensive cyber operation. How do you do that as a team? And we provide the environment inside a VMware platform to execute those training missions and mission rehearsals.
Your boot camp and full forces. You're training everybody.
Everybody, yes.
Obviously, that's huge pedigree and credentials. Congratulations.
Appreciate that.
Take us through the state of the market, because, you know, cyber is always, I mean, it's not for the faint of heart, that's for sure.
Absolutely.
We know that. Take us through some of the training things you're working on now, because the bad guys get a lift, the good guys get a lift. It's a ratchet game of cat and mouse. It's been talked about. There's a lot of defense. There's also strategic, proactive things you can do. What are some of the state-of-the-art things you're working on?
Yes, I mean, so a few things, right? So over the past year or so, we've gone through a massive expansion of our platform. So the idea is that there's multiple cyber protection teams out there. The more people we can get through training, the better prepared they're going to be for that sophisticated attack from some nation state out there, right? And so over the past year, we've expanded our platform. We've quadrupled in size. We've implemented new multi-tenant security measures using Avi and vDefend and things like that to make those internal systems more resilient, right? We're able to execute malware in our systems, offensive cyber attacks in our platform, and maintain that security of our platform as we move through it. So we're really trying to keep up with the state of the art of security within the platform so that we can allow our cyber operators to execute really the full range of cyber attacks and defense inside the platform while maintaining that multi-tenant secure environment.
And the relationship to VMware, vDefend, and you said Avi?
Yes, absolutely.
How's that going?
So I've been in IT training for the Department of Defense now for about 26 years. During that time, I've gone from your hardwired legacy systems to primary virtualization to software-defined platforms, right? The type of data that we deal with is obviously very sensitive, so keeping that secure is primary to us. Putting that in the public cloud is something that we don't want to do. And so when we looked at this, we kind of understood the scale of what we're going to be dealing with over a period of about 8 years. And having something that we can deploy as a software-defined data center and scale out both our load balancing, security policies and protocols as we expanded and our user base expanded, the load on the platform expanded was primary to us. And I'll be honest, right? I mean, not just because we're at Explore, but there's not another competitor on the market that can scale with us and provide that automatic scale-out security that we get with VMware.
Really? That's use your ears there. Testimonial right there
yes.
in theCUBE.
Absolutely.
He's all smiling.
Thank you.
He can't pay for that. All right, talk about application security in the AI world. I mean, you know, model poisoning, it takes one record.
Yeah.
That's all it takes.
Yeah.
Huge vulnerability. All kinds of other techniques. What are some of the things, give us some confidence. We're already enthused. The hype cycle's at all-time high. What are some of the things you guys are working on to lock that down in a good way, give the confidence so that these models just don't go off the rails?
Yeah, I mean, we've put a lot of effort into identifying how do you trust the model, right? Developing a standard. We're actually working with some universities and other companies to develop a standard of how you would test the model to develop trust in that model, right? Not just the model itself, but the data that it's been trained on. Is it biased, right? Does it hallucinate? How does it hallucinate? Things like that. And then actually, I haven't seen anything novel come out of the AI world as far as cyber attacks, which should put a smile on your face,
yeah.
right? However, agentic AI is allowing that malware to move at a much more rapid pace, mm-hmm. right? So our defensive operators have got to be able to keep up with that. But I'll tell you, the one thing that kind of keeps me up at night is 10 years ago, if you had said to me, I'm going to put some software in your platform and I'm going to give it all the administrative rights to mess around with your identity manager, actually modify, modify commands inside your system to troubleshoot and correct issues, right? That's giving software administrative privileges in your system that you never would have done before, but now, since it's backed by AI, it's okay.
Yeah.
And even things like network traffic analysis out of vDefend, right? It's going to have real problems identifying when somebody's created a vulnerability to get into either your model or the platform that's running that model. You no longer have that network insight to see that something in the regular chain has been broken, because part of that regular chain is giving that model the ability to run those administrative commands in your platform. So most of our standard tools today aren't going to be able to realize that something is wrong.
It looks like an agent doing its job.
Exactly.
All right, so let's talk about the MCP. I mentioned that on the open. A2A is another protocol. This has been a great organic development in
yes.
the community, comes from the open source, and so people like it because it's delegations involved, some trust, again, quotes, trust.
Right.
Talk about the, there's a lot of action. Tool chains are getting easier to build with Gen AI, yeah. so the tools to do the security also enables the tools to fight against for the hackers. So MCP, is it secure? How do you guys look at that? What's needed and compared to A2A, for instance? Because, you know, it's not just an API call. This is delegation. This is, like you said, here are the credentials, go do things.
Yeah, exactly. So I look at MCP like this. We've actually got a steering committee right now looking at MCP to kind of understand what it is, how we're going to bring it into the platform, how we can secure it long term. I don't think the security measures that we have in place today are good enough. We're actually looking at building our own AI gateways specifically to enhance the security for MCP before it goes back to the models, right? If you look at what we've done in the past, right, MCP is what? It's basically a USB port for ML, right,
yeah.
for AI models. We didn't trust USB systems in the past
yeah.
because you can plug something in and it just propagates through your platform. We aren't going to run into this trusting MCP either. And you know, to the rest of your question, right, how do you trust it? How do you get to that level of trust? I don't know yet.
So it's
right?
a software problem.
Absolutely.
This is going to be, and so I want to get back, you mentioned identity before. We were talking about cryptography before we went in. There's a lot of math out there right now, proofs, that's becoming very valuable in, you know, saying who you are. So in cryptography, there are ways to prove who you are without any kind of knowledge of who you
Absolutely.
Are. How is all that playing in? I don't know if that's maybe a quantum question, but it's more of a cryptography question. Is that coming in? Do you guys see any of this coming down?
Take that one first.
So I think yes, because our customers are asking for that support, because with quantum computing, you know, today's cryptography, eventually you can break it through enough quantum computing, and you know,
yeah.
it's, oh, it'll take you so many computations, 5 years, no.
Because
quantum
instantly.
Computing, you could zoom down and do it much faster. So, you know, NIST has published some new higher entropy
yeah.
algorithms and for cryptography, post-quantum computing, and a couple of large banks and other government agencies want to be on the forefront of
yeah.
utilizing that technology, so we have rolled it out on the Avi front. We're supporting it. Broadcom, NIX already supported, but that's in hardware. We have to do it in software also yeah. at layers above.
So you've kind of got the readiness thing going on with quantum readiness inside the platform.
Yes. I don't know.
Oh, we're not ready.
Okay.
No, no one's ready. Who's ready? No, but they're trying to get ready, but again,
yes.
you have to start doing it.
Yes, because we want to make it available for the early adopters, which are some, don't want to name the banks, which have asked for that support. That's
All
why we
them.
Went and did that feature.
And long
some
line.
Some government agencies. So they are going to be yeah. the early adopters, and then the rest will follow, right? As the technology gets more, less compute intensive, because we have to spend cycles to do the
yeah.
encryption today.
Yeah.
Well, to what I'm hearing from you both is, when you are thinking about AI and talking to customers about it, are you more excited about the potential, or are you more concerned about the increased surface attack? Because when it comes to down to it, we've not yet had the big one. We've not had a Pearl Harbor cyber attack. We've had incidents here and there, of course, that get a lot of media attention. But we've not had a 9/11 in cyber. How do you think about it? How do you have conversations with your customers about it?
So customers are concerned, and you know, it's both a concern and it's an opportunity. If we can solve that problem, clearly customers will be more interested in our product, so we do want to solve the problem. The way I look at some of these attacks is, Gillon said, like, they might not be able to crack things, but they can keep probing forever, right? Write an agentic AI kind of a thing, and you keep looking for that little hole someplace and get in, which normal attackers, it may not have been possible to do it. They'll just keep running around, and so it could be the next version of bot, but more powerful as they are attacking. And eventually they will find a side door and get in. So you have to find ways to protect it. And there will be advanced attacks, but at least let's stop all the basic ones completely, so that then you can dwell on the super advanced one, the new attacks which show up. Because today even the normal ones, or the so-called slightly advanced ones, are not protected. So let's get all that locked down completely, so that then teams can focus on the super advanced attacks.
Yeah. Yeah, so from my perspective, I am super excited about AI for many reasons, right? I mean, it brings the world's knowledge into your hands, right? It's incredible. It's a level setter across, you know, social spheres, right? However, from a cyber perspective, I'm not completely terrified of that big one, right? So eventually something will happen that will go down in history as the attack that changed everybody's mind, right? And I see that. But I do actually, I mean, from my perspective, and I'm going to pat ourselves on the back, right, from Cyber Command on down, I have faith in the cyber protection teams and cyber mission forces that have been trained in this specific area, right? They've done a great job. I mean, just recently, last month, St. Paul, Minnesota, right, they got hit with a ransomware attack. It was a very sophisticated attack, lots of resources behind it, and the city just couldn't get over it, right? They were down for weeks. And they called in the cyber protection team from the local National Guard in Minnesota, and they were able to get them back up and running, right? So they were down for weeks, but they called in the guys who've been trained to do this sort of work and keep America safe, right? And even though our enemies are very sophisticated, I think that our teams with the right training, I think that they are better.
And what you guys do is so important because we've never had a cyber military. Because attack digitally is like troops landing on our soil.
Exactly.
Why wouldn't you deploy a team to assist?
Exactly.
Versus companies building their own militia.
Right.
Which is what they still do, but this is where the platform advantages come in. So I think the scale piece is also interesting. Any thoughts on like some of the data scale as you get more and more data coming in? Because there's a lot of sharing in the cyber community.
Absolutely.
People share information.
Yes.
I heard that there's a day minus zero where it's like you can start seeing the formation of a team being constituted in the dark web. I've heard things like that. I mean, this is kind of the new data coming in. What's your reaction to that? What's your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot happening every single day. Right? It's literally impossible to keep up with everything that's happening, right? I think that our platform really provides some of those cyber mission teams an advantage, right? So we have people that can go out into the field, they can get information, they can bring it back in, they can test it in a safe environment, they can figure out what it does, and maybe even use it to their own advantage, right? And then from just a data perspective, right? So I know that for us, we have petabytes and petabytes and petabytes of storage space and data, and it's being distributed across multiple of our environments that people can go and use, right? But this is very specialized information. And so,
AI helps you too. There's AI for security and security for AI.
Absolutely, I actually just saw that a minute ago. I don't know who coined that term, but it was great. So just being able to access that data isn't good enough. We actually need to use AI to basically build massive RAG platforms to consume that, right? So somebody will have to go in there and be able to do a natural language query to figure out what they're looking for, right? There's just too much for any one human being to go through and figure it out, right?
Exactly. Well, this has been a fascinating and wide-ranging conversation, Umesh and Gillon. Thank you both so much for coming on theCUBE.
Thank you so much.
We're closing the place down here. Look at this.
I know.
Beautiful.
I know. And I'm Rebecca Knight for John Furrier. Come back tomorrow for more of our live coverage of VMware Explore. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.
Really appreciate the incredible coverage theCUBE provides, not just for this show, but for